Hello, for this first International NASH Day, we'll be talking about diagnosis. How can we identify this disease which can develop over a number of years without any symptoms? In this program, we'll be welcoming Professor Augustin, a doctor at the University Hospital in Barcelona. We'll also visit the Salpêtrière Hospital in Paris, where they carry out biopsies, the only way to undoubtedly diagnose NASH. We'll welcome Professor Dufour from the University of Bern to talk about the latest research on blood test diagnosis, an alternative to biopsies. And finally, we'll interview the coordinator of a European project that focuses on the future diagnosis methods. Professor Augustin, hello.
Hello.
You're the head of the NASH program at the University Hospital in Barcelona, and you're regularly faced with diagnosis issues. Is it possible to obtain information on the state of one's liver with a simple blood test?
There are simple blood tests, like we call transaminases. If you have elevated transaminases, you probably have some inflammation going on in the liver, but it's very unspecific. It could be due to NASH, or it could be due to because you took anti-inflammatory drugs, or you took antibiotics, or you have another disease. So it's not very specific.
But it's an indicator.
It's an indicator there's something going on with the liver.
Say my blood test as a patient, my blood test results are sort of abnormal. What happens next for me as a patient?
Okay, first thing is that you're probably going to be referred to a specialist. Once we rule out all the causes, we have a check on your medical history to see whether you have or not risk factors for NASH, which is
genetics, lifestyle, etc.
Exactly.
Are you going to add other tests, say, for instance, imaging techniques type of tests?
Yes. I mean, the first thing you will order in such a patient will be an ultrasound, a liver ultrasound.
What is it?
It's like a very simple, similar to what you do to pregnant women. And that way you can diagnose whether the patient has a big amount of steatosis or whether the appearance of the liver is bad.
And based on the appearance of my liver, can I actually deduct whether I have NASH?
You will find in a good proportion of the patients in which you suspect that you have the appearance of having fat within the liver, which is not exactly...
Fatty liver.
Yeah, exactly. But we shouldn't stop there. The main technology that's been developed is called transient elastography, which is a fancy variation of ultrasound, okay? And it assesses the stiffness or the rigidity of your liver. When the test comes out very low, where the liver is soft, that's a very good thing. We're confident that the patient, even in the case that he or she may have some amount of NASH, it's not damaging at this point the liver that much. We can repeat that in 2 years, 3 years, and monitor the progression of the disease. If the test comes back very, very bad, we probably can be confident in saying that the patient has cirrhosis. But there's a big margin of values in between in which we are not sure.
So what would the most reliable test to do then?
In that case, we use a liver biopsy.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Augustin, for being with us today and for all this information. We're precisely going now to the La Salpêtrière Hospital in Paris to meet with Professor Ratiou. To diagnose NASH, Professor Ratiou performs biopsies, which is quite invasive for patients. But today, biopsies, as we just said, are still the only way to diagnose accurately the stages of the disease. Let's look at it.
Pitié Salpêtrière Hospital in Paris. Lionel arrives this morning for a hepatic biopsy, a test that will help his doctor assess the state of his liver.
J'ai des résultats au niveau du foie qui sont pas au-dessus des normes, donc ils veulent savoir d'où ça vient. Donc l'analyse de foie est nécessaire car les radios, tout ça, n'ont pas donné de résultats suffisants.
The biopsy will be done in the day hospital. Lionel will be able to go home mid-afternoon. In the next booth, Dominic is also waiting for a biopsy. This is his fourth. Diagnosed with diabetes 20 years ago, he now has grade 3 NASH.
C'est pour vérifier l'état du foie, savoir si la stéatose, cette fibrose, a empiré ou est stable. Il y a 4 grades. Si vous passez au 4e grade, votre foie peut se scléroser. Donc après, c'est, hein, faut aller à Lourdes si on peut.
Lionel is ready for his biopsy. First, Professor Radziu gives him a local anesthetic.
Ça fait pas mal, hein, non?
Non, non.
15 minutes later, it's time for his biopsy. The doctor will remove a small sample of tissue from the liver with this syringe.
Il y a un instrument spécial, c'est-à-dire en fait une aiguille un peu plus longue, un peu plus large, puisqu'il faut qu'on arrive jusqu'au niveau du foie qui est profond. Respirez plus. Respirez tout doucement. Ça va?
In under a minute, the biopsy is over. The piece of liver removed is sufficient for analysis.
Cette biopsie m'a permis de recueillir un fragment qui est très long. Et malgré l'importance du matériel retiré, il n'y a pas eu de douleur particulière.
Cet examen permet de savoir s'il y a donc cette souffrance du foie et si le patient est au début du chemin vers la cirrhose, au milieu, ou s'il a déjà atteint le stade de cirrhose.
The sample is immediately sent to the anatomic pathology department. The tissue will be prepared over several days. It will then be analyzed. Under the microscope, the liver cells, or hepatocytes, are clearly visible.
On voit ici la fibrose en rouge qui va s'insinuer entre les cellules hépatiques et qui va détruire progressivement les cellules hépatiques. Ici, donc, vous avez la ballonisation hépatocytaire, c'est l'accumulation d'eau dans les hépatocytes, et qui est un des éléments de la NASH. Et vous avez ici la stéatose, qui est l'accumulation de graisse dans les hépatocytes. Et vous voyez ici, c'est le noyau de l'hépatocyte, il est refoulé complètement par la gouttelette de graisse. Et puis il y a un quatrième élément qu'on appelle les cellules inflammatoires, qui vont s'accumuler entre les hépatocytes. Là, c'était une fibrose débutante, pour ce cas précis. Donc c'était une NASH pas très évolué.
The samples from Lionel and Dominic's biopsies are undergoing analysis. They'll come back in 10 days' time to get their results.
Professor Dufour, hello.
Hi.
You're an hepatologist in Bern, Switzerland. After watching that story, I've got a question that comes to mind. Could we perform biopsies on a large-scale basis among population?
Absolutely not.
Why not?
Because you have seen you need patients who will take a day off work to come to have the biopsy. The biopsy is, you know, need some expertise. You need to have trained people to do it, but also to analyze it. It's coming with some costs. So this is not an examination that you can perform on a large scale. You have to triage the patient to identify already patients where you think that you will find something to do the biopsy.
So how do you select those patients then?
Right. This is exactly the big question now in the field. You know that 25% of the world population has a fatty liver, but 10%, maybe a little bit less, have actually lesions that we can call steatohepatitis.
NASH.
Then you have the NASH, which means non-alcohol steatohepatitis.
Okay, I see.
So obviously, you need to do better than what we do actually to be able to maybe continue to do biopsy to reach the diagnosis, but on a significantly smaller population, because you will have tests that you can do before that increase the likelihood that you will find something, or you can say you replace completely the biopsy by a new test that will actually give you non-invasively the same information.
So I guess one of the key issues is to find the right diagnosis method. And you, Professor Dufour, are taking part in what we call the Litmus Project. What's the Litmus Project? It's a 5-year European project aimed at improving NASH diagnosis. So let's discover what Litmus is all about with Professor Anstey, who's in charge of this endeavor.
We know that a large proportion of the population have fatty liver disease, but we need to find the people who are going to come to harm as a result of it. At the moment, we're quite reliant on liver biopsy, but we need to move to better diagnostic tests that don't rely on biopsy. And so Litmus is there to help us develop, validate, and qualify better non-invasive diagnostic tests, either based on blood tests or imaging or other near-patient testing technologies, so that we can diagnose the people who need treatment. There are a number of things we need to know about how fatty liver disease progresses. We know that people who are, if they're overweight, have diabetes, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, or more of those features, we know that they are at greater risk of progressive fatty liver disease. So we can use that information. But on top of that, we need biomarkers. These can be specialist blood tests or imaging tests that we can use to pick out the people at the greatest risk of future disease progression.
So, Professor Defour, we just saw that Litmus's goal is to develop an efficient diagnosis technique for NASH. With the European Union spending over 34 million euros for that project, does it mean that there is an emergency there?
There is an emergency in the way that we know that we have many patients with this disease. These patients need to have a clear diagnosis.
Several research projects are currently underway to develop these biomarkers. We'll now see a short animation film regarding diagnosis of NASH.
With 34% of the adult population worldwide affected, NAFLD is emerging as the most common chronic liver condition in Western populations. The prevalence of NASH is also expected to grow in conjunction with the growing obesity and type 2 diabetes epidemics. Since no effective medication is currently available to treat the disease, it is growing as a major economical and societal issue for many countries. In the United States, for instance, NASH is expected to become the leading cause of liver transplantation by 2020. The total cost for a liver transplantation was estimated at $812,500 per patient in 2017. Not only does NASH increase the risk of cirrhosis or liver cancer, but it is also associated with higher risk of cardiovascular disease. The problem is, NASH is a silent disease, and patients can remain unaware of their liver condition until very late stages. Hence, from a clinical standpoint, one of the major challenges is to diagnose NASH at early stages. For this, physicians need a simple, reliable, and cost-effective solution to identify patients at risk of progression and intervene while the disease is still reversible and not life-threatening.
Professor Dufour, is it totally far-fetched to imagine that one day we will be able to diagnose NASH with just a simple blood test?
I think it will be possible, because we already know that there are some parameters in the blood that correlate with some part of the diagnosis of NASH. So maybe if you refine that, if you complement this, you will reach a level of accuracy where we can call this test a biomarker.
Let's now take some questions sent in by web users. I've got one from Carlos. And Carlos asked the following question: what should I say to my general practitioner to order a NASH diagnosis?
Currently, there is no NASH diagnosis. So what you could say is ask at least your GP to perform what we call the transaminases, which is what we call the ALT and the AST. I mean, a lot of people know this test. And so when you have an increased activity for this enzyme in the blood, you actually know that there's some suffering in the liver. So this is not specific for NASH, but this is at least a test that will tell you that there's suffering in the liver. And so then you can
It's alert. It's an alert.
Yes.
It's a wake-up call.
It's a screening test to know if this patient has liver disease or not.
I got another question from Eva, and here it is. If I have an ultrasound of my liver, will doctors be able to tell me for sure whether I have NASH or not?
Absolutely not. Not now, unfortunately. They will be only able to say if she has more than 30% of her liver cells with triglycerides. So even for steatosis, it's not very accurate.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Dufour, for being with us. The next program for this very first International NASH Day will cover the consequences of the disease from a medical and a societal standpoint.